Listening Library presents Just Mercy, adapted for young adults, a true story of the fight for justice. This is the author, Bryan Stevenson. To all the young people I've had the privilege to represent, love is the motive, but justice is the instrument. Reinhold Niebuhr. Introduction. Higher Ground. I wasn't prepared to meet a condemned man. In 1983, I was a 23-year-old Harvard Law School student working at an internship in Georgia, eager and worried that I was in over my head. I had never seen the inside of a maximum security prison and had certainly never been to death row. Georgia's death row is in a prison outside of Jackson, a remote rural town. I drove there by myself, my heart pounding harder the closer I got. I was convinced that this man was going to be very disappointed to see me. I didn't really know anything about capital punishment and hadn't even taken a class in criminal procedure yet. I didn't have a basic grasp of the complex appeals process that shaped death penalty litigation, a process that would in time become as familiar to me as the back of my hand. I studied philosophy in college and didn't realize until my senior year that no one would pay me to philosophize when I graduated. I was uncertain about what I wanted to do with my life, but I knew it would have something to do with the lives of the poor, America's history of racial inequality, and the struggle to be just and fair with one another. I found two programs that seemed like the right fit at Harvard. I could study law while also pursuing a graduate degree in public policy at the Kennedy School of Government. Not long after classes began, I started to worry I'd made the wrong choice. I felt less experienced than my peers. I'd never even met a lawyer before starting law school. I felt very fortunate to have been admitted, but by the end of my first year, I'd grown disenchanted. Harvard Law School was a pretty intimidating place, and the courses seemed disconnected from the race and poverty issues that had motivated me to study the law in the first place. While my classmates put on expensive suits and interviewed at firms in New York, Los Angeles, or Washington, D.C., I spent the summer after my first year in law school working with a juvenile justice project in Philadelphia and taking advanced calculus courses at night to prepare for my next year at the Kennedy School. The public policy program's curriculum was extremely numbers and statistics focused, leaving me feeling adrift. Then, suddenly, everything came into focus. I discovered that the law school offered a one-month intensive course on race and poverty litigation, taught by Betsy Barthelet, who had worked as an attorney with the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. Students were required to spend the month with an organization doing social justice work. So in December 1983, I found myself on a plane to Atlanta, Georgia, where I was scheduled to spend a few weeks working with the Southern Prisoners Defense Committee, SPDC, now known as the Southern Center for Human Rights, or SCHR. Their mission? To defend condemned people on death row in Georgia. I met Steve Bright, the director of the SPDC, on my flight down. Steve was a brilliant trial lawyer in his mid-30s. He'd grown up on a farm in Kentucky, ended up in Washington, D.C. at the Public Defender Service, and had just been recruited to take over the SPDC. Unlike so many of my law professors, there was no disconnect between what he did and what he believed in. When we met, he warmly wrapped me in a full-body hug, and then we started talking. We didn't stop till we reached Atlanta. "Bryan," he said at some point during our short flight, "capital punishment means them without the capital get the punishment. We can't help people on death row without help from people like you." I processed what he meant. People without money or capital were the ones who were punished. I was taken aback by his immediate belief that I had something to offer. He broke down the issues with the death penalty simply but persuasively, and I hung on every word, completely engaged by his dedication and charisma. It was deeply affirming to meet someone whose work so powerfully animated his life. I just hope you're not expecting anything too fancy while you're here, he said. Oh, no, I assured him. I'm grateful for the opportunity to work with you. Well, we live kind of simply, and the hours are pretty intense, he warned. I quickly realized he wasn't kidding. There were just a few attorneys working at the SPDC when I arrived that winter. In their 30s, men and women, black and white, these lawyers were prepared to fight for the rights of the condemned and those facing unjust treatment in jails and prisons. After years of prohibition and delay, executions were again taking place in the Deep South. Most of the SBDC's lawyers had come to Georgia in response to a growing crisis. Death row prisoners couldn't get lawyers and were being denied their right to receive counsel for legal advice. There was a growing fear that people would be killed without ever having their cases reviewed by skilled counsel. Every day, we got frantic calls from people who had no legal assistance but whose execution dates were on the calendar and approaching fast. I'd never heard voices so desperate. When I started my internship, everyone was extremely kind to me, and I felt immediately at home. I did clerical work, answering phones and researching legal questions for staff. I was just getting settled into my routine when Steve asked me to go to death row to meet with a condemned man who had been there for more than 2 years. My job was to convey to him one simple message: you will not be killed in the next year. Driving through farmland in rural Georgia, I rehearsed what I would say when I met this man. Hello, my name is Bryan. I'm a student with the... No. I'm a law student with... No. My name is Bryan Stevenson. I'm a legal intern with the Southern Prisoners Defense Committee, and I've been instructed to inform you that you will not be executed soon. You can't be executed soon. You're not at risk of execution anytime soon. No. Soon I found myself pulling up to the intimidating barbed wire fence and white guard tower of the Georgia Diagnostic and Classification State Prison, or as we called it at SPDC, Jackson. This was a hard place. When I told the visitation officer that I was a paralegal sent to meet with a death row prisoner, he looked at me suspiciously. I waited until he brusquely directed me to the small room where the visit would take place. Don't get lost in here. We don't promise to come and find you, he warned. The visitation room was an empty metal cage. It was small, and although I knew it couldn't be true, it felt like it was getting smaller by the second. I began worrying again about my lack of preparation. I'd scheduled to meet with the client for 1 hour, but how would I fill all that time? I sat down on one of the stools that were bolted to the floor and waited anxiously. Finally, I heard the clanging of chains on the other side of the door. The man who walked in seemed even more nervous than I was. He glanced at me, his face screwed up in a worried wince. He was a young, neatly groomed African-American man with short hair, clean-shaven, medium frame and build, wearing bright, clean prison whites. He looked immediately familiar to me, like everyone I'd grown up with, friends from school, people I played sports or music with. The guard removed his handcuffs and the shackles around his ankles and then locked eyes with me and told me I had 1 hour. The officer seemed to take pleasure in our discomfort, grinning at me before turning on his heel and leaving the room. The metal door banged loudly behind him. The condemned man didn't come any closer, and I didn't know what else to do, so I walked over and offered him my hand. He shook it cautiously. We sat down, and he spoke first. I'm Henry, he said. I'm very sorry were the first words I blurted out. Despite all my preparations and rehearsed remarks, I couldn't stop myself from apologizing repeatedly. I'm really sorry. I'm really sorry. Okay, I don't really know. I'm just a law student. I'm not a real lawyer. I'm so sorry I can't tell you very much, but I don't know very much. The man looked at me worriedly. Is everything all right with my case? Oh, yes, sir. The lawyers at SBDC sent me down to tell you that they don't have a lawyer yet, but you're not at risk of execution any time in the next year. We're working on finding you a lawyer, a real lawyer, and we hope the lawyer will be down to see you in the next few months. I'm just a law student. I'm really happy to help. I mean, if there's something I can do. The man interrupted my chatter by quickly grabbing my...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.